What's going on, everybody? Welcome to T3G. My name is Haris.
Dalibor.
And today we are reviewing X-Men. I'm super excited about that review.
X-Men Apocalypse. This is our first podcast, guys. Things are a little different. We're doing things a little differently.
Yeah,
now.
we're gonna have this as also, you know, we're doing it on YouTube, but we're gonna have it as a podcast as well.
This will be our first podcast. Yeah. Welcome to our first podcast. Sorry for the audio if it's not good. If it is good,
awesome.
Ignore that.
Yeah. let's talk X-Men, man. Listen, here's what I don't understand.
All right, let me.
What do people want out of movies? Because remember when before this movie was available to most people, mm-hmm. right? People were coming out and they're like, "Oh, it's not a good movie. It's a disappointment coming from Days of Future Past."
Somebody said that it was a franchise-ending disaster.
Are you serious? I didn't
that
even see
that.
That
was the title of that article. Franchise-ending disaster.
Can we talk first? Do we understand what people want out of movies? I don't think we do.
I don't think anyone does.
I
don't think anyone knows what people are looking for. At least the people that complain about movies. The people who write about movies.
Right.
I just don't think that the people who make movies know how to please the people who want to talk about movies.
I mean, here's the thing.
Because the people that want to talk about movies and that, you know, that's like their thing. Like, we talk about movies here a little bit.
I wouldn't say we're professional.
This isn't our thing. Our thing
I wouldn't
is
say
type
we're
of video. Our thing is kind of varied. We do the nerdy stuff, some cons, whatever. We do different stuff. But people who, let's say, that's what they do, like Jeremy Johns, John Campia, those people who are just, that's their thing.
That's all
that's
they
their
do.
Bread
that's,
and
yeah,
butter.
That's number one.
They seem to want something that the people who make movies aren't doing, and they don't know how to because there is some sort of disconnect.
Yeah, man. I mean, there's definitely a disconnect because I would know where this movie was amazing. I would put this, as I told you before, I would put this in front of Civil War.
And that's the thing. You look at the stuff that people said about Civil War, and I think fandom has to take part of it.
I mean, yeah,
you know, people love the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
And here's the thing. I'm not a fan of Fox because they still ruined Fantastic Four. So that's a thing. But you got to give them credit on this.
People love the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And they are... Let me turn my audio off here. People love that. And they're going to have a bias. So when they talk about Civil War, they were talking, you know, like the month and a half early that they saw it. They had this huge hype train. Every time someone would talk about it, it is mind-blowing. The best action sequence ever.
Which, that alone.
We didn't
do a spoiler review on Civil War, but
I don't think it was necessary because I thought it was a good movie. You know, whatever. That's its own thing. But it was one of those things that when they said that, I was like, all right, like I'm going into it. I saw that sequence. I thought it was a good sequence.
Yeah.
I thought it was a good action sequence. Yeah. I didn't think it was the greatest action sequence.
No, I would never put it in. Like, it was a great sequence.
When I talked to people, when I talked to just regular people, they said that their thing about that was, it was, you know, there was a lot of cool stuff happened in that action.
Absolutely.
A lot of cool stuff happened.
Yeah.
But still, as far as how it was filmed, like you mentioned, it was there was a lot of that jump cam because a lot of moving parts.
Yeah.
So your camera's just going everywhere at the same time.
Absolutely.
So that's the difference is that you're not focusing on one fight. You know, you look at a fight scene like we discussed in John Wick. That final fight scene the major fight scene in the gun battle in the club.
In the club and in his house, both of those are just
insanity.
Insanity.
The way those were filmed.
And by the way,
execution,
just in case
beautiful.
You believe it was a stunt double, believe me, it was not. It was definitely Keanu Reeves. He's proven to gotten injuries off that crash.
Yeah, no,
so.
he did an excellent job. That's what I'm saying. Like, to me, that's a bigger achievement.
Yeah, absolutely.
Than this
CG.
CG,
yeah. Like,
you know,
here's
like
the thing, it's not even them doing it, it's not stunt doubles really doing it, 80% of it is CG, 80% of it is computer generated.
I'll even say that most of that sequence was filmed, and then they were like, oh, we got Spider-Man,
right.
Now let's work Spider-Man into this.
Yeah.
So that's why I feel like that line that Falcon said, when he said, oh, everybody's got a gimmick, that was just like a throw-in because...
Yeah.
hey, now we're throwing in another guy like an animal thing. Yeah. But anyway, so there's a whole lot, like the way people talked about that movie after the debacle of Batman v Superman and how just people destroyed that movie, to then come into X-Men Apocalypse of this huge wave of people saying it was not good.
Right.
And then when it actually came out, people doing new reviews of, it's maybe actually good?
Right.
Like, maybe these people who saw it early aren't correct?
No, not at all. And
they weren't. This movie was very, very good.
This movie was...
I don't want to say it was an excellent or perfect movie.
No. Listen, it had problems, but it's fun. It's not a career-ending movie. It's not a franchise-ending movie.
As far as movies that are focused on a team,
right?
I think this is one of the best ones.
Oh, absolutely.
I would say this might even be the best team-oriented movie.
Yeah.
Like, Captain America was a Captain America-centric movie, which is why none of the other characters really got development, even though you really did get a lot of development for, like, Black Panther, even a little bit for Spider-Man. But in, like, Avengers, there's not a lot of character development there.
Yeah.
Because his is... That's the thing. That's what Avengers has always been, is you get to read Captain America and Iron Man and Thor. Those are separate books.
Right, and then
read their stories.
And then here's the Avengers.
They're just going to fight huge battles, insane cosmic odds, and that's what Avengers is. That's what we always want out of it. Some people complain about, like, it was just like a big fight, and they just fight this big, you know, they fight a million Ultrons, and then they kill the main guy.
Yeah.
That's what Avengers do.
Right.
There's not a lot of story there. But with the X-Men... Dude, I cared about every single development.
Oh, yeah.
And people are complaining that they're misusing Mystique. Oh, that's not the character from the comics. This isn't the comics.
Listen, none of these comic book movies are the comics. First of all. Second of all, if you were a comic person at all, we've already said this before, think of it as another Earth or another world. It's not going to be note for note. It is a different reality. Look at it that way. They're not going to give you page for page.
If I want to see the comics, I'm going to read the comics. The only thing that I've seen a perfect translation of has been some of, let's say, the DC animated movies. And even those, they modify and they change.
Yeah.
I mean, the Killing Joke is coming out
soon. Earlier, let's not even talk about the new ones. We're talking about the earlier ones, because the new ones are even...
Yeah, now it's just like...
with a bunch of different stories in one.
Yeah, 15 different stories in one. But let's say even you're looking at, like, The Dark Knight Returns.
Or Flashpoint Paradox.
Flashpoint Paradox. Perfect example. Dude, that's a 7-issue storyline that was huge.
Yeah.
And they're like 90 minutes. Not even.
And they did a good job.
They did a good job, but it's like you left out a lot of things.
Oh,
you didn't develop certain things. So it's not going to be as big.
No.
So if I want to read the comics, I'll read the comics.
Absolutely.
If I want those exact stories, they're already there.
Yeah.
You know, it's like the people who are complaining about movies being remade... It's the same thing. If you're mad, let's say if you're
movies
if
are always
you don't,
gonna be remade because
if you don't like Ghostbusters, just go back and watch
absolutely.
The old ones.
Yeah,
they're
I
still
have
there.
The old ones.
No one's deleting the existing copies.
I have the old ones. I have them on Blu-ray and regular. So like,
no one's going around collecting them.
Yeah, nobody's
they're
gonna
not
going to
erase them
me.
Out of history. It's still there. You don't like the new one? Watch the old one.
All right. We've discussed how we don't understand what people
here, for instance, in X-Men, this trilogy, First Class, Days,
I think it
Apocalypse,
built out excellently.
Outclasses the original X-Men trilogy by far.
This is definitely, man, I mean, Days of Future Past was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
It was amazing. I almost want to put 3 right after 2. Usually it's 2-1-3 is how it goes for me, almost on every movie. But I want to put 2-3-1 on this because I believe this was better than 1.
I agree. I completely agree. I think X-Men First Class was good. I think it was a necessary
step. It was a good movie. It was a good movie, without a doubt.
Yeah, it was a necessary step to set up this new team and new actors and everything. I think Days had way bigger action.
Right.
And, you know, this is the end of the world versus that was the end of the world. So, like... I can't even say that it was like a bigger scope or bigger, you know, stakes, but it felt bigger.
Right.
It felt because you had time travel involved, you had way more characters because they had the, you had the extra mutants in the future, you know, you had all these like little Cannonball, Warpath, characters that you never saw.
No, that was great.
That was really, really cool.
Yeah, that's
they
why
did
I would
really
say
well.
That's why I would say 2 is better than 3. Yeah. Even though 3, I don't know what people are talking about, was amazing.
Apocalypse is fantastic. I think the story was beautiful.
I agree.
I think the execution of Apocalypse was really, really good.
I think it was dead on, man.
My only beef with it is the voice.
But I like the voice because it kept changing, right? When he got upset.
Yeah, and they did the modulation, and that was fine. They definitely did. They did justice to the feel of Apocalypse.
Sure.
I just
want a deeper voice because you're used to the show.
The voice of Apocalypse from the animated series was so dead on to me for the character overall.
I mean,
like, when I read Apocalypse in any scene,
that's the voice in
my head. You know, it's like when I read a book after I've seen a movie, I play those characters.
Sure.
And I'm even after seeing X-Men Apocalypse, I'm still going to play the X-Men 90s show Apocalypse.
Because
even when they did Apocalypse in, what was it, Evolution, I didn't really like that voice.
I even forgot that they did him in the
They did, man. And I liked the voice in the original better. So that was really the only disappointment for me. People said, like, oh, there's not a lot of development for Storm. I would have liked to see a little more, but it's not like I was disappointed.
Well, here's the thing.
All these other characters.
Well, let's go into this. All right, let's talk. Let's list off things and see how we agree and disagree.
Sure.
Okay. So we both agree that the storytelling by far is great. I mean, I wouldn't put it anything less than great.
Yeah.
I think the development of every character overall is really, really good, if not great. I think what we saw out of Apocalypse was amazing story-wise. I think seeing how Charles was kind of more, because we always say he's like the behind the stuff, but now it felt like he was definitely more involved in it. He was definitely utilized a little more with his power.
Yeah, yeah. And that was one of the big, that was one of my biggest takeaways, is they executed the last, that whole last scene with, well not last scene, but the whole last fight scene with him on the astral plane while everyone's just kind of sitting around like, what's going on? That is a huge takeaway from the comics because that's happened so many times.
Oh, God, yeah.
One of the biggest ones that comes to mind when I saw that scene is from the late 80s, Battle of Shadow King, where literally, so long story short, Xavier had gotten his legs back in a new body, essentially, and he had come back from Shi'ar, from space, to fight the Shadow King because he had taken over, like, Muir Island, so like Moira MacTaggert was under his control. This whole huge scenario, right? And he's sitting there, and he just goes into this astral plane battle where the X-Men are just sitting around him,
right?
Like nothing much is happening on the physical plane, but then this whole huge battle happens on the astral plane. And when I saw that on screen, and they're all just sitting there, like, you know, what the hell's going on? And then Jean jumps in, and I'm like, dude, this is exactly from the comics.
Yeah.
Like, the feel of this is perfect.
Absolutely.
And that was the biggest thing for me, is it wasn't shot for shot. It wasn't
for
scene.
Of course.
It wasn't Zack Snyder's Watchmen, where it was like, this is the comic, this is the screen, and it's like the same shot.
Yeah, it was the same.
It doesn't need to be that.
It doesn't
But
need
the
to be that.
Feel was so good.
I agree.
It was, and then, you know, the Jean jumps in, she does the whole Phoenix thing on the outside, and she's in there, like, destroying his mind. Like, I could not have asked for a better astral plane sequence than that. It could not have been better.
I definitely have to agree with you. Obviously, we both agreed that they're going with whole Jean Grey, Phoenix always being inside her instead of
which
her.
Which is fine. I think
which
that's
is
more,
fine because
more
it
towards
also
the
was,
ultimate.
Right, I was going to say, because it was kind of introduced like that in the comics. Not right off the bat, but it was.
They eventually said that it's like it's drawn to her, so it's always
part
of her or whatever. It's part of, you know, like it's in the Summers or Gray line.
Yeah.
So that's fine. I don't mind it. They don't need. I don't need a huge like space arc of them going into space and then falling back to Earth for her to get the Phoenix. It's part of her. Cool. It's like an ultimate manifestation.
Right.
It's her ulti in Overwatch.
Right. If you haven't noticed, we've liked our Overwatch. Let's say, so we agree with the story acting. I mean,
I think the acting was excellent.
I think Kurt Wagner from the previous one was better, but I still like this kid.
I agree.
I think.
I mean, man, I always mess this up. I feel
my apologies, Nightcrawler. If you don't know his real name,
so. I want to say, was it Ray Park in the last one?
I can't remember the guy's name. Truly cannot.
I feel like Ray Park was Toad.
But I think that was Toad. Yeah, Ray, because he's the actual action guy.
I thought that's when he came back in 2, I thought whatever.
No.
Whatever. Whoever did, I feel like it was
Ray. No, it wasn't. No, Ray Park was Toad, I forgot about that. Because he's the martial artist and slash parkour guy.
Right. Yeah. So, I think the way the character was acted in X2 was better.
Yeah, I agree.
Than this one, but he just because he had a bigger role in it.
I agree, yeah.
Every time he talked, every time he said his name, I wanted him to be like, but in the circus, they call me. That's what I wanted. I wanted to see that because that was such a great
But he did a good part job. Of that he character did, he did in a good X2. Accent, I think, overall. Yeah. He definitely sounded younger than the other guy because obviously the other guy is older. I enjoyed it. Obviously, I don't think they're going with the whole Mystique's my mom. That would not make any sense. I think she would have to have been 13 to have him.
Yeah, no, I feel like they're not going to go that route.
I don't think they're going to go that route.
And that's okay. I'm okay with that. She's going to be his mentor. I hope they don't try to, like, romantic them.
Right.
That'd be really weird.
Yeah.
I understand it's a different universe, and maybe they're not related in this one.
Sure.
Still be really weird for me.
Still be weird because you got to remember. Because
there's this huge thing, those were big stories.
They were big stories.
Those are big stories, and they have been huge effects of those stories in the comics.
Yeah.
So if they
try to... in the animated series, it was also
upon, and so. It was one of those things that, like, if you go down this route for me,
yeah,
I'm not gonna be happy.
Yeah.
But we'll see what happens.
Yeah.
I like him. I like Jennifer Lawrence.
I was okay with Jennifer Lawrence. Here's the thing. I don't think she's a bad actress, don't get me wrong. I just don't think she's as good as everybody believes she is. I think she is a great actress. I just don't know if she's that great, right? Because I feel like the previous actress, which was O'Connell's, funny enough, because we were just talking about him, I think she was his wife, actually, at some point, and then she married Stamos, the chick that previously played Mystique.
Rebecca Romijn.
Yeah. I feel like she did a better job.
She did, but she played a fundamentally different character.
Yeah, absolutely. So, she definitely played
The difference in those two characters is the second movie.
Yeah.
In the version of Mystique that we saw in X2, she committed the assassination in was it France or whatever?
Wherever
the Trask meeting was, she did that assassination, got away with it. Yeah. And
she
went down that dark path.
She was definitely the darker.
She went down that dark path. Whereas with the events of Days of Future Past, they changed
all that. Yeah.
So that was one of those things that.
Yeah. No, I get it. I'm just saying. I feel like she was made
to look like the hero.
Right.
And she wasn't ready for that mentally, which is why I understand why she's, you know, more in her blonde appearance and not her blue appearance. Sure. And I understand that, but at the same time, I feel like they underuse her abilities.
I agree.
Because
saw a change to a different person once, I believe.
Right.
Which was the dude where it said they went that way.
Right. I would have liked to see.
And we didn't even see him fully. We just saw his finger, which is ironic.
Right. I would have liked to see her hop back and forth to different people.
I agree. Which we saw a lot more in X2.
Yeah.
We saw a lot more because she was Wolverine. She was.
And that's the thing is. Here, they're bringing her more into the role of a mentor and an X-Man.
Right.
And that's a departure from existing stories.
Yeah, absolutely.
Even when she was an X-Man, it's not the comics, so we expect
some things to be different.
Even when she was an X-Man, she was still, like, very much hardcore assassin Mystique. Right. So now to see her as more of a teacher, it's different. You know, we're not going to get that subterfuge, I'm going to go and become 5 different people so I can get to my target.
Right.
Like, I think that could be something maybe explored down the line with a different actress in a completely separate series. I think we're going to see a completely different Mystique than we've ever known in comics, and I'm okay with that.
I feel like she did a better job if you're comparing acting. To me, I felt like she was a little better for it.
Yeah. I honestly think the one thing that did bother me as far as
I know people are going to disagree, and I get it.
Which is fine. The one thing that did bother me, it felt like every time she was shown in blue, it felt like they hadn't finished, like, fixing her hair. Her hair looked weird.
Yeah, it did. I thought I was the only one.
It looked oddly shaped. But maybe it wasn't, like, matted down properly, but it just didn't look right. And that it like momentarily took me out of the scene.
Here's my question. Now, speaking of visual, I believe these were better visuals than Civil War by far.
Than Civil War?
I mean, we've had quite a few complaints about visuals in Civil War. You could tell a few times Iron Man was CG.
Yeah.
Lot of, like, the background was CG. Like, it took us out a little bit in Civil War. Where here, I don't
the
remember.
The only thing, really, that I can think of in X-Men is the thing with Mystique's hair, like,
but besides
and that's a physical thing.
But that's a physical thing.
The CG itself,
I think it was great.
I think it was a big enough story that even though, like, you've got these magnetic fields and all this stuff is floating and breaking everywhere, I think it was a big enough story. It had a big enough feel that even though, like, literal cities are crumbling,
right?
I think it felt natural.
Yeah.
It didn't feel like it was CG pieces falling apart. Sure. It felt like cities were falling apart. So in Civil War, people were saying that you felt like there was more of a human element, more that you could feel the casualties. And yeah, of course you could. That was the point of that movie.
I mean,
think about the casualties of these huge fights. That was the whole central theme of that movie.
Whereas in this,
it was like, the entire world is at stake.
Yeah.
We don't have time to show you each individual that's at stake. Hey, here's some wide shots of people being like, those are missiles being launched.
But here's the thing. Here's the thing to me. Even the missiles, I mean, the missiles being launched. But Xavier specifically states he wants to get rid of humans. Like, it is the most, it's the biggest, most dramatic moment in the movie where he states that to the team because he's like, he doesn't want to, you know, eliminate us, but he wants to get rid of all the humans. Like, if you don't feel any part of that when he says that, then I don't know what else more. I mean, they clearly tell you that this is a fight to keep humanity, not a fight to keep mutants alive.
Exactly. It was very much a matter of
because I mean, if they were worried about it, they just let it happen.
It was a matter of the stakes are so big that we don't have the time or the opportunity to show you the minutia. Yeah. We don't have the time or the opportunity to show you a close-up of a bridge of, you know, like, of people running scared.
Yeah.
No, because we have to show you that this is happening simultaneously on every continent worldwide at the same time.
Yeah.
I don't want to see shots of people running out of their cars and stuff.
I don't need to, though. That's the thing.
You show me that London is being disassembled.
Yeah, you show me that a few people
I'm good.
Are being
I get
disassembled.
It. It's
get
fucked
it.
Up. The it's, situation it's, is all
yeah,
fucked up.
It's messed up. All right, so we agree the story is good. We agree that acting is good. I do want to mention real quick. Yeah, they didn't explain Psylocke too much, but I thought overall she was very well used.
I thought they set her up very nicely.
I think she can be a very, very beneficial in the next story.
I think she can be maybe because she's already on the outside of the law.
Well, here's the thing. If we haven't already mentioned this, because we haven't actually said any spoilers yet, we are going to be...
We have.
Not really.
Phoenix thing.
But even then. Like, so what? They showed the Phoenix? Meh. They showed her in the third one and the last one. If you didn't expect
That's fair.
If you didn't expect that, what do you want? But, yeah, she's outside the law, but at the same time, she wasn't... Like, you could tell that when she noticed that he was ready to betray them all, like, she was ready to be like, maybe this isn't the right direction, right? Maybe
right,
this
but
isn't
she
the
also
right
wasn't the touchy-feely, like, oh, I'm going to join
she definitely wasn't.
Join in on this thing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
She was like, all right, I'm going to watch to see where this goes.
Yeah.
And she's like, all right, now I know what I'm dealing with. I'm going to go.
Yeah.
I'm going to go.
Yeah.
I have things to do.
The only thing I do
I'm
wish,
take
but
this
which
higher
makes
power
sense,
set now.
Which makes sense why they didn't use it. I mean, I guess it doesn't really make sense, but I mean, I'm okay with it that they didn't, but in the comic, she's able to teleport.
Well, that's a whole different story.
Right, I understand that.
That's,
I'm just saying...
They're never going to go in
that. I got that, but I mean, I'm just
they
saying...
They did use it in X3, though.
I'm just trying to say is that it would have made sense when the plane was crashing for her to teleport away from that dangerous point instead of fall down.
And that was awesome.
Which was dope. I mean, don't get me
wrong. She jumped, and I was like, dope, but what are you going to do now? Right. Like, what's next, chick?
But I'm like, we haven't seen you use the portal yet, so I'm like, are you just going to do it?
Well, it has to be a shadow.
Okay.
So her up there, she would have had nothing to shadow it anyway.
That's true.
She would have to get in the jet and fall into a shadow. But they did use that, and
I mean, that sequence was great.
Yeah, but and here's the thing, and if we're saying that maybe some of the same events are still going to happen, that would be a great story to tell. Yeah. The Crimson Dawn story was good.
Yeah.
It was a good story. Was Angel dead at the end?
No.
How they just stopped.
They just stopped them. Like, I believe, I'm trying to remember exactly, but somebody forced them into like a wall.
Right.
Yeah. Actually, I almost want to say it was Apocalypse, because he was ready to betray Apocalypse. I think he was actually ready to jump in on Apocalypse. I can't remember now. I can't remember 100%.
Whatever.
It's been a few days. It's been actually a week.
I think he was done well. I think my only... what I really liked about Angel was the way they did his power set before he got the boost.
Right.
With the one claw on his wings, on each wing. I thought that was really cool. That's a different take on Angel.
Right.
That puts him more
I enjoyed Angel. I enjoyed Angel. I enjoyed that he gave him, like, the carvings in his face a little bit, too, at the end.
So instead of giving him the mask, he gave him the...
I thought that was pretty cool. I liked Angel. I would like to see that also develop a little more. Also, we spoke about this. We don't believe Alex is dead. One, because we didn't see him die.
There's no body. I'm sorry.
Well, here's the thing. Even if there's no body, we did not see him die. There was never one moment where we see him get hit by the explosion.
Right.
He was gone.
I'm thinking he got buried. He got buried before Quicksilver got in there.
Right.
Because the explosion had already happened.
Or he got grabbed.
I mean, if he was close enough, yeah.
Yeah, I think he was, and I think he got grabbed.
Well, regardless, I think Sinister has him.
I think here's absolutely Sinister.
Here's the
has
thing
him.
In the comics, and again, we've said this is not in the comics.
And
but
by the way, since we're gonna go into this, why are we saying Sinister? Because if you wait after the credits, there is a scene. It says SX Corp, and that is Sinister's corporation. And Sinister will be, ironically, in the fourth movie. Because, I mean, that's a hell of a setup if you're not going to do a fourth movie.
I really, really want Cranston to do it. I want Cranston to do it, and I want
him ironic that that man said...
It made sense.
But
made
here's...
Sense
I mean, I get it made sense. Hey, but it's ironic that a year ago, when this movie was being filmed, he was like, well, I'd like to play Mr. Sinister.
If you remember... Before there was ever a new trilogy,
sure.
When X3 finished,
yeah.
I told you my plans for 4, 5, and 6.
I got you.
And it started with Sinister showing up at the school.
I mean, yeah, absolutely.
And now it's like, oh, Sinister. I also included Cable.
Well, here's the thing.
Now they're doing
Cable. Well, here's
Cable.
The thing. Well, here's the thing. Hold on a second, though. They could have left Sinister for, unless they do Onslaught for the sixth movie, which holy a story.
No, they can't. There's not really a way to do that.
I mean, I think there might be.
No, because they've sown the seeds of Magneto being essentially good in all three of these.
I got you, but he leaves, which he did in the original trilogy.
But
they said he left Xavier.
The way Onslaught is formed is... The dark core of Magneto.
I got that, right.
That Magneto is good.
I understand that, but here's the thing. Here's what I'm thinking. Once again, this is in the comics. So I'm thinking, because I could be wrong, but because there was a moment that Apocalypse was inside of Xavier, there was a close moment when they were transferring each other. Boom.
Takes the...
See? Because there was a small moment. And I don't think Apocalypse is also fully gone, because when he does regenerate. I don't know how far his regeneration powers go, but clearly they go pretty far. But when he was looking at the Phoenix, he's like, and it has been revealed. So, I mean, there could be multiple plays on what creates ultimately what creates onslaught to come.
Yeah, absolutely.
So
I think Ted, what that was to
so
him,
they could set that up for the sixth movie pretty well throughout the next three movies or to the next
when
two
he,
to
when,
the third.
When he's X'd by Phoenix at the end, I thought that was a great scene,
yeah.
A great moment. I felt like that was Apocalypse coming face to face with his own concept.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Like, the strong will survive. When he saw that, he looked it in the eyes, and he realized that he was not the strong.
Yeah.
And that was that moment, and I thought that was perfect.
Oh, that was
I thought that was absolutely
beautiful.
Oh, that
was great. That was absolutely great. Now let's talk about this. Since obviously we already talked about Essex Corp and Sinister being in the next movie, we're super fucking excited because Deadpool, if you haven't watched it, I don't know why, at the end of Deadpool, he says, oh, by the way, Cable.
So and he
listen.
Cable, but here's a little quick little background. Long story short, really, really long story short.
Really, really
Cable
long.
Is the son of Cyclops and a clone of Jean Grey. The clone of Jean Grey is created by who else?
Mr. Sinister.
Yep. Mr. Sinister, Nathaniel Essex, is a geneticist. He's been a follower of Apocalypse for centuries at this point. And he's been into genetics since, like, before genetics was a field.
Yeah.
So he is very ingrained in the Summers bloodline. He's very ingrained in the Jean Grey bloodline. So it is not a far stretch to say that he's the reason Cable exists.
I agree.
It's not a far stretch at all because he had Wolverine's blood, which is, by the way, how we get Laura.
And I was telling my wife
as I was walking out, I was like, which is how we get Laura, which is how we keep having a Wolverine.
Well, how
movie.
We keep having one, because I was telling my wife, I'm like,
because now you have a female
I'm like,
Wolverine
if they
movie.
Go Done. This route, if they go this route, we have a female Wolverine, and this is how Wolverine gets replaced. Dope! And she's like, why would you say that? I was like, that's how his daughter technically gets created, is with his blood. And I'm like, that's... And it's Sinister, so this.
But he also. But remember, he also had like three or four other vials,
which I'm assuming was Jean Grey. I'm guessing.
I'm thinking Jean Grey because I think they had like a red and a yellow. I'm thinking Jean Grey Cyclops.
Right.
And,
or I mean, it could. They don't have to go with Cyclops. They could say Alex if he has Alex.
Right, but that's what I'm saying. I think he had three other ones.
Yeah.
So I think he had four at the end. So he had. I'm thinking the Grey Summers, the other Summers, and Logan.
Yeah.
I think that was the full set at the end.
All right, well, regardless, we talked about a lot about that, but let's talk about Wolverine. Now, you said you were upset that they showed you the moment they showed the claws and where it was at.
Because I,
but here's
and
the
I
thing.
100% called that entire sequence.
Well, you called that it was going to be at that location.
Him breaking
but,
out.
But did you expect him to be in that suit? To be in that getup, which we did not see in the originals.
No, we didn't.
So did you
I thought that was a good homage, but I mean...
I thought that was a great... When I saw it, I was like, well, I didn't expect that. I didn't...
That
I
was the only, that was the only thing I didn't. As soon as they showed me that, the claws in the trailer, the flyover over Alkali Lake, I was like, okay, so they go to the Weapon X facility, he's there,
but that's fine.
They
I mean,
free
it would
him,
make
and
sense.
He goes
fine,
crazy.
But it would
I was
make
like,
sense.
Awesome. All right.
But that's fine, but it would make sense. I mean, you would have known that regardless.
But that was just a plot device. There was no reason for any of that.
Well, there was.
There wasn't.
There was, actually, if you think about it.
Like,
what? Here's the reason. Here's the reason. Let me tell you the reason. Hold on. Let me tell you the reason. The reason for that is because they rewrote Origins. So they're telling you his origin without telling you his origin.
But my question is, how did Stryker get him? At the end of days, it was Mystique as Stryker.
Right.
So how the hell did Stryker get him? Because she had him. Did she deliver him to Stryker?
Who knows?
But she knew who it was, obviously. She recognized him. So that's my question is, I feel like that was plot device. That was just like, okay, we need to get him into Metal Claws. Let's just say this already happened.
Yeah.
And we move on with our lives.
Absolutely. Well, that was
and she's like, I gave him something back. And I was like, Logan, okay, cool. I get it. We can move on with
that. Yeah, no, I get it too. But, I mean, I'm just saying, I liked it. I liked it a lot. I mean, even if they didn't show me the clip, I would have expected to see Wolverine, even when they said, hey, Wolverine's going to be in there. Even if they didn't show me the clip, there's only one way Wolverine's in those scenes at that time period, and that's that. So,
right. No. I mean, I knew exactly what was going to happen, but I just...
I mean,
I would
rather
not show that at all. Just the claws. Show the flyover Alkali. Like, who cares? Like, no one's going to connect those dots.
I was okay with it because I did not expect knew it was coming. What they did, and I was
as soon as he showed up at the X Mansion, I knew exactly what was going to happen. I knew exactly the next 10 minutes of the movie.
Well, that's fine. I'm just saying I did not expect him being in the Weapon X, like literally what he looked like in the pages for a few.
I didn't ahead of time, but as soon as they showed him in the cage,
yeah,
I knew he was in that costume.
Yeah. Well, yeah, obviously, but I'm just saying, like, I didn't...
costume. Like,
right. You know, we say costume.
And the monitoring gear.
Yeah.
It's monitoring gear.
But I loved it. I absolutely loved that part. I absolutely loved
it. I think it was great. I think that sequence by itself is better than the entire X-Men Origins Wolverine movie.
Yeah, absolutely. God, yeah.
That was a better origin for Wolverine than that entire movie
was. We got a lot more to talk about, so let's go ahead and finish this up. So I'm going to say one thing. Quicksilver, amazing. I love it. Keep doing it. Quicksilver's awesome.
Beautiful.
His scenes... I love his scenes. I love, especially the mansion scene, but I love his scenes. This kid can do Quicksilver for me as long as he wants.
He's really, really good at it. What I really liked about him, I thought that mansion scene was beautiful.
Oh my God, the mansion scene, I was smiling. Beautifully executed.
And then at the end, they're like, where's Alex? And he's like, I'm pretty sure I got everybody.
Yeah.
Like, at that point, you can't even be mad at him.
Yeah,
like,
right.
Even if he missed one dude, he got 100 students out. Right?
And the way he got him out, bro, was like, great. The way he got him out was amazing.
So,
I loved it.
But my favorite part of him was towards the end where he faces Magneto and he's like,
but it
this
doesn't tell him, yeah.
He said, this is what I'm here for.
Yeah.
And he's like, and you, he's like, I'm also here for my family.
Yeah.
Because he's like, this is not the time for this conversation.
No.
I need him to know that I'm also here for family. That's the... we can discuss the intricacies of this later.
Absolutely.
We need to get him off this...
I can't talk how much I enjoyed Quicksilver in this movie. I honestly... his scenes made a lot of this movie for me. Don't get me wrong. The movie is phenomenal. But his scenes made a lot of this movie for me. I just loved it. I mean, the comedy that comes out of him, the seriousness moments, just it's awesome.
It was fantastic. I think he went in and went one-on-one with Apocalypse was great. That was awesome.
Yeah.
I wasn't expecting that at all. That was one of those things like, wow, like Quicksilver would... I mean, like the Quicksilver that I know and have read would not have gone in to face Apocalypse one-on-one.
Yeah.
And that's like the young brashness of him is that he's just gonna go and do it. We'll see what happens.
I loved it. I loved it. I absolutely loved
it. I think he was done beautifully. What my biggest thing in this movie was how Apocalypse brought people to him. It's not brainwashing.
No. It's just
which is what it was in the comics. Yeah. It was like we twist your brain.
Yeah, no.
You now work for me. Yeah. You will live and die.
It was straight manipulation.
And it was just like, bro, here's some more powers.
Yeah.
We cool?
Yeah.
We cool.
But it was not even just that, but he played into their...
Yeah. It was like,
what they wanted.
Yeah. You feel like you're underrepresented and you're not... Yeah.
For Storm, it was to show her potential, to show her that
strength.
She doesn't have to be scared.
Yeah.
He was there for her.
Yep.
For Angel, it was giving his wings back after they got fucked up.
For Psylocke, it was power.
For Psylocke, it was straight power. For Magneto, it was like, pay them all back for what they've done.
Yeah.
Like, and here's how you do it. You have the power to do
also,
it. And seeing Magneto's power.
Also, can we address the fact at the end of this movie, we have four really hyped up power people.
Yeah.
We have Magneto who can now affect the
world.
The entire... planetary magnetism.
From what I understand, their amped power stays with them because I don't think they go away if he dies.
I mean, there's no reason for them
because
he boosted their own power. It's not like he gifted them powers; it's that he boosted their own
power. He clearly
powers.
Did not have to be near them for them to have that power.
Right.
So I'm assuming they still have the boosted.
But
power.
The best part of Apocalypse in the comics is that he's always around.
Yeah,
his touch is always present.
Sure.
So, even, let's say, in the comics, Archangel got his wings, and then years, like, 15, 20 years later...
Which only is, like, 2 years in the comics.
Well, yeah, but I mean, like, a long time later, his metal wings molted and his regular wings came back. Yeah, yeah. And it was like, well, this is all part of Apocalypse's grand plan.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it's like the plan is bigger and bigger, because then after that he had this energy wing and like the ability to heal. So like this, it changed even further.
Well, that's the thing.
So it was one of those things that his touch is always there. His manipulation is always going to remain. Because Caliban, who was Psylocke's boss, I thought they did Caliban extremely well. Mm-hmm. He's like the hustler. The
I liked him. I liked him a lot. I liked.
He was done really well, but actually, it's great that they brought him in there, because Caliban took Angel's spot on the Four Horsemen when he broke out of his programming. So, and he became like this big brutish hunter. I think he was still a death.
Yeah.
But he was like he was a hunter because he could find mutants. That was his power.
Yeah, yeah, I got you.
So I thought that was really cool that they included him. Yeah. You had Archangel, you had Caliban. I'm trying to think if they had anybody else.
Because they had Wolverine for a while.
Wolverine was in there as well. So you had three horsemen that were in the comics horsemen. So I thought that was interesting.
Now, here's my question real quick before we finish this up. Speaking, actually going back to one subject about Sinister and the clone of Wolverine or his daughter.
Sure, Laura.
What if... I hope they go female Wolverine, because that would be a smart way to go. Introducing a badass female character. You think they might just make a clone of a younger Wolverine...
They could. I mean, that's one way to get around that.
Right.
I would hope they would go for Laura, for X-23, primarily because she presents a completely different fighting style.
And she is the current Wolverine regardless.
Right. Well, she presents a completely different fighting style.
Sure.
Instead of three claws on her hands, she has two on her hands, one on her foot.
Right.
So she's got a completely different fighting style.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then you also have this stigma, because she's programmed by Scent.
Yeah.
So she, when she leaves the program, when she, you know, leaves the facility, she still has this trigger.
Yeah.
So she's actually been triggered on multiple occasions, right, you know, without her knowledge, without realizing it, to just like execute a bunch of people that she's in the room with.
I guess we'll both agree that we would love to see that.
Mm-hmm.
I think we both agree also that we're worried that they don't have the balls to do it.
There is that. There is this fear in Hollywood of having a powerful female lead. I mean,
Here's the thing.
You can't really show me a movie where they've had, especially a superhero movie, where they've had this huge... Like, I think if Wonder Woman does well, it'll help that cause.
Well, here's the thing. I don't think anymore it's a worry about having a powerful female superhero anymore. I think their problem is...
She also has to be part Asian,
well,
which is another big issue.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, I think their biggest... Which they introduced in Wolverine 2, or Wolverine, where he did... Was she Asian? Yeah, he was with that chick that was Asian.
Oh, in the Wolverine.
Yeah,
in the Wolverine. That's not who she's...
Like, no, I know, but I mean, it's not the comics, so they could play it off in that sense.
I mean,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, they could play it.
But here, what I'm thinking is, I think the reason they might not have the balls to do it is because everybody knows Wolverine is a male, right? It's a Logan. I think a lot of people don't know there's another Wolverine that is a female, that is his daughter / clone, which I think they're worried... If they change that up, people might not get it. You know, at least the comic book, non-comic book going people. So I think that's why they won't have the balls. I don't think it has anything to do, because we saw a powerful character. We saw Jean Grey be powerful, be the ultimate ending to Apocalypse.
But there's a powerful female character in a movie, and there's the powerful female lead.
No, I got you. Well, right. I think it's the biggest ones that are gonna do it for most people
Wonder
is
Woman,
Captain Marvel and Wonder Woman.
Captain Marvel and Wonder Woman are gonna really set the stage.
I agree. And one final thing about the movie, and here's why they couldn't. Here's my belief, because the original movie came out 1999?
2000.
And let's be serious. What was Daredevil 2000, or that was 2004? I can't remember.
It was 2000 and this is really... I'll tell you why I remember, but it was 2002.
Okay. In my opinion...
Mm-hmm.
Well, let me say this. The suits at the end fucking awesome. I love it. God, I lost my mind. Here's the thing. Now, most people are going to be like, well, why couldn't they do that in the original three? Because it was 2000. The only thing they knew is either the black suit or spandex like Daredevil had, which everybody hated. So, that's the thing. Now they have Daredevil in the fucking Netflix series, which looks great. It's not spandex. It looks like functional suit.
Well, that's why now
they did it. Now they showed it to us because they know how to make it look right. Because now they've figured out how to make materials.
Exactly. Because let's say you tell somebody, oh, well, they're wearing, you know, it's like, oh, it's body armor. It's just, you know, color.
Because, I mean, look at the reason Batman's suit works now, because it makes sense, right? Back in the day. It was a rubber suit, and then at some point it had nipples. Like, they couldn't get it right. So now they know what they're doing with suits, and that's why we saw suits. Not 100% what they are, but I thought they were amazing. I lost my mind. I had the biggest smile when they turned around and everybody was not black.
It was Cyclops.
That's why everybody... Do you keep seeing the image where they show like Wolverine's suit in like a suitcase?
Yeah.
And I keep thinking, I'm like, if that's for the movie, I can't wait to see that on screen. Even though it doesn't make sense for Old Man Logan. But then again, we both agree... But yeah, it could.
Be like a flashback.
Well, here's the thing. I mean, it could even for the entire movie, to be honest. Because let's be serious. I don't think they... We both agree they can't do the full Old Man Logan. They can do a similar story, but they can't do the Old Man Logan story because they don't have the right story.
Listen, I don't know if I've said this before on video. I'm not that impressed with the Old Man
Logan story. Me and both. It was good. Yeah, it was good. It wasn't bad, but it wasn't mind-blowing. I don't know what everybody was talking about. Regardless, I thought it was great. I had the biggest smile when they turned around.
Nightcrawler was so on point.
Oh my god, was he not?
Nightcrawler was so on point that I was like...
I loved it.
I'm like, why can't we just do this?
That's great, dude.
I thought Cyclops was a beautiful adaptation. You gave me the 90s homage without it being pouches and stuff like that. I thought that was perfect. I thought Storm was actually a really nice blend of the modern costume and the old style. Who else did we have? We had Beast, which I thought was... He went with more like a rugged, almost the Secret Avengers look.
Yeah.
And then, who else was on there? I can't even think. Gene, you saw a little bit of the 90s costume?
Yeah.
Just a little bit.
Just a little bit.
The lines were there. That was the important part. Who else was there?
So we had... Obviously, Nicole, Xavier Cyclops, without his hair. Xavier without his hair, which was actually a really cool way of doing it. Like
Storm, Beast...
And then obviously,
I think that's it.
Mystique,
another really great adaptation of her costume, because her costume essentially was like a white one piece, and they had this white main line down the middle. Also, it allows her to not be in full blue body paint the whole time. Which is like probably a lifesaver and a time saver.
Oh my god, by far, because they've always talked about how long it takes to put on that kind of makeup. I thought that was just the ultimate. I loved it. Here's the only one thing. Now, here's the thing. I'm not upset about it because there were so many characters. There was so much to develop in this movie. Yeah. So I'm not mad at all. The only thing I hope for the next movie is they utilize Jubilee. I want to see her utilized.
I was also a little bit upset when they...
I was happy to see her. She looked exactly like Jubilee.
They made a big deal about it, absolutely,
because she looked like Jubilee. I mean,
oh, they also made a big deal about it in the like while it was shooting. Jubilee's in it. They're at a mall. Blah blah.
Yeah, but
it was like that was the one sequence.
That wasn't really anything major about it. So I would say if there's any major disappointment, it would be Jubilee's character. But I hope that... Listen, there was a lot in this movie.
There was
so much in this movie that I can't even... How do you put in a character that's so significant?
I would actually rather see Jubilee take the center stage in a Generation X movie.
Oh, absolutely.
Give me a Generation... Since we're going to be doing X-Force, give me a Generation X movie where...
Which they have spoken about, considering that to come back.
You know, give me Emma Frost. Bring in Emma Frost.
Yeah.
This is not hard stuff to do. Bring in Emma Frost. Have her be an old friend of Xavier. She's a teacher. This is easy stuff.
Yeah.
Easy.
Yeah.
Banshee is dead. So Banshee can't be the other teacher, which sucks, but you know... You could use Hank. You could use a number of other people.
Yeah, you can definitely use different people.
But you could bring Jubilee. Like, give me a different cast. Because that's the great thing about Generation X was that they, because it was the 90s, they went really, really hard on diversity.
Yeah.
So you had Jubilee, who's Chinese. You had Jonah, who's English. You had, and who has a really amazing power.
Right.
He has a open chest cavity with power just spewing out. So really cool visuals. You have Sink, who's black. You had M, who was Islander. Her story is so convoluted that I don't even want to get into. And then you had Mondo, who is also Hawaiian, I believe.
Right.
And then you had Skin, who is from L.A., and he's Mexican. Yep. So, like, hugely diverse cast, and I think that would be beautiful.
Absolutely. I completely agree. I think that would be... I mean, I don't see why not, especially if you're going to be doing... I just lost it. You just said the name. Not Generation X, but the other one.
X-Force.
X-Force, thank you. Oh, my God, that slipped. Next happened. Honestly... If you can't make it happen as a movie, make it as a show.
Yeah.
Put it on Amazon. Listen, I get it. They might not get Netflix because Marvel's with Netflix. So
sure.
I can see why maybe Fox couldn't be with Netflix. Fox does own a TV channel.
Fox is also part owner of Hulu.
Right. And if that's the case...
Dude, you throw a superhero show on Hulu, guess who's got a Hulu subscription?
I'm almost willing, if you do something, because Hulu's got some cool shows now, and if you put stuff like that on Hulu, I almost might have a subscription for that too. Even though at the current moment, I'm not really the happiest with Hulu, but...
I am 100% for on-demand.
Listen,
on-demand
if done
content.
Just do it right.
Dude, I was this close, because I'm trying to catch up to NCIS back half of the season, and I was this close to signing up for CBS All Access, because then I have it.
Yeah.
Then I can watch whatever the hell I want.
Absolutely. Here's the thing. If there's no as long as Fox and directors, here's the thing, everybody blames Fox for Fantastic Four. I blame both. The director clearly had a lot of issues, and
there's definitely problems there.
So, as long as they don't do what happened in Fantastic Four, we're okay. Honestly, the best showing is do what you did with Deadpool. Leave everything to the guys that love it.
Yeah.
Like, if you get people who love what they're doing, and they're crazy about it, you are going to be successful in every way possible.
Ryan
Reynolds did with that, and the team for that movie, it's all them.
I genuinely hope that that's what happened with the Gambit movie. Gambit movie got pulled from the roster.
I hope so,
right
too.
After Deadpool came out. And I feel like they looked at that, they're like, well, $57 million did this, and this opening weekend.
Yeah.
Why do you guys need 150 exactly?
No, absolutely.
Let's talk.
I mean, listen,
let's pull you off the schedule. Let's discuss.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Because here's the thing. Me and him always discuss, like, some of the money numbers don't make any sense.
Are you telling me $57 million made Deadpool?
Yeah, and listen,
you
don't
can't
get me
tell
wrong,
me that $57 million can't make
here's
a Gambit
the thing.
Movie.
You can definitely
same
tell, like,
the
Fox is a CG and stuff, but that's $57 million. So if you're telling me if you add another $30 million, make it 100 even... You don't think it would be a better movie? Absolutely, it would be a better movie. And that's why Ryan Reynolds got the back end that he did, and he should have gotten even more, but that's a whole different conversation.
Right.
But in all honesty, here are my final thoughts, final reasoning why I think this was better than Civil War. I think acting is on par with everybody from Civil War. I think, without a doubt, I think the acting's on par. I think the visuals are better, because I've had a lot of issues with Civil War with visuals. I think that has to do with the things they had to add, and I think they were rushing it. Even the Russo brothers said Civil War wasn't even supposed to happen, but then Batman Superman got announced, and they were like, boom, I guess we're going to be doing Civil War. So, it did feel a little rushed, because there wasn't even a more of an explanation for Iron Man, like I said, for me. And here's the thing, I didn't hate Civil War. I loved Civil War. I just think it wasn't as good as people are saying. Like, people give it a perfect rating.
I don't think it was as good as it could have been.
So, the reasoning, once again, acting on par, visuals better. I think the storytelling was better, because, once again, Iron Man and stuff like that. I think storytelling was better. I think the creation
I think overall
of Apocalypse
I think,
and stuff
I
like
think
that.
Beginning to end, you had no question about people's motives. You had no question about how and why things are happening.
Exactly.
You had a clear explanation and clear drive for everything.
Yeah.
And that's, I think, the main difference between the two. I think, largely, the last act of Civil War was forced.
Oh,
it was like, all right, we have this thing, and like, here is our conflict.
Yeah. Okay, without a doubt.
Here is the Civil War conflict. And now, ignore that entire conflict, and now we have this
whole other thing. Story. Yeah.
Whereas this is like, Apocalypse is coming.
Yeah.
And then at the end is, we just finished fighting Apocalypse.
Absolutely.
One story.
I think the few little things like the suits, Wolverine, the way he was introduced, I think all that added to that, and plus Quicksilver, I think this just makes it an overall better movie. I know people are going to disagree. I know people hate on that. I love that everybody's bringing out these movies. The only movie out of all the comic books movies that we've seen that I hated was Fantastic Four, the new one. And that's just
and
as
that's
simple as that.
A breakdown in
and
storytelling,
exactly.
A breakdown in characterization.
So I'm not disrespecting Marvel. I'm not disrespecting their actors, their directors. I think everybody does a phenomenal job. I actually love every actor that's in almost every one of those movies. Both
except
as
Don Cheadle.
Yeah, screw Don
Cheadle.
I like Don Cheadle as an actor.
I just don't
he
like
him. He doesn't like
him
as... Yeah, that's a whole different conversation also. But I think overall the reasoning for this movie, and we're some of us are going to be disagreeing with this, but I always say there are facts that cannot be disputed because they are facts. And I think in this portion, this is definitely going to be more of a subjective, you know, an opinionated thing. But I think it is a better movie. What are your final thoughts on that?
I also think that it is a better movie than Civil War.
Yeah.
It's totally different, so you can't say,
absolutely.
You can't say
absolutely.
That, you know, shot for shot is better,
right.
Because there is something, there is something that gives you a better feeling when it's a bright and happy movie.
Absolutely.
Even though Civil War was a very, very serious movie,
it was really serious.
And had a lot of emotional points,
it's still a brighter,
it happens outside in the daylight. Most of X-Men Apocalypse happens
under
cloud
cover.
It's
all about how you set the tone, of
course. I mean, it's the difference between Man of Steel and Superman 2, the Richard Donner version.
Yeah, exactly.
I think its story was beautiful.
Yeah.
I think they executed Apocalypse as well as you could possibly expect to execute that insane of a character and story.
Right.
As possible.
Yeah.
I don't think you could have done it better.
I 100% agree with you.
I think Xavier's progression was perfect.
Yeah.
People were complaining that, you know, I read a couple comments here and there. Oh, so Xavier, like, lost his hair because of... I forget what they said, but basically, like, he lost his hair because of Apocalypse. I'm like, yeah, but originally he lost his hair and had his back broken by Lucifer.
Right.
Like, I don't remember, I think it was like an alien or something calling himself Lucifer or whatever. But like, bro, you understand, like, these stories were written in the 60s. Anything you do now is on par with that, in my opinion.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think that, like you said, the acting is great, the story, the visuals are great. I really couldn't have asked for more. Your main cast was developed.
I agree.
I liked the dynamic shift, right? I liked the dynamic shift of Alex and Scott.
Yeah.
In the comics, and this has always been true in every version of the comics and even alternate realities.
Yeah.
Scott is the good guy.
Right.
Scott is good at everything because he had to be.
Yeah.
Because as soon as his vision came in, he had to be better at everything.
Yeah.
And Alex was the slack off.
Yeah.
Alex was the troublemaker.
Yeah.
And this universe,
Alex
was the first X-Man.
Yeah.
You know, it's completely opposite. So I thought that was a beautiful dynamic shift. And then that last line that they said when they were talking about Alex, and he said, oh, like, you think he you know, he's like, he was going to be the one that make something big of himself.
Right.
And he's like, it's funny because that's what he always said about you.
Right.
And I was like, oh.
Yeah.
Like, and that, those were those moments where they really, they get you. Those emotional moments. You know, just that little bit of exchange with Quicksilver and Magneto. Beautiful. Yep. And I was like, oh, man. Like,
I loved it. I definitely want to see it again, for sure, in the theater.
Yeah, without absolutely.
I'd love to go see it again.
I think it hit the right story notes, the right visual notes, and it definitely hit emotional notes. I think Captain America, to me, was more of a visceral movie.
By the way, great movie. I just feel like we have to mention that, because I feel like once we say something negative, oh, we think it's an awful movie.
Well, I think the difference here, the difference in the two movies is this. This was front to back a single, well-crafted story,
right,
that included the things that were necessary, mm-hmm, and really didn't include things that weren't.
Yeah.
I agree. Shove in, like, we would have wanted more Jubilee, but like if we had gotten Jubilee, like,
felt like it in was the fight, in, yeah,
like then we got to watch out for her. Is she going to be as powerful? She's not at that level. She's not field ready.
And even for Psylocke, like if we got a bigger story out of her, it wouldn't have. But that's the thing, it wouldn't have been needed.
Exactly, and Psylocke's story is so huge that don't give me like a taste of it.
Shit, honestly, give me a separate movie. I think she could be a great separate movie on her own.
A separate movie, her own series. Here's the thing. Anything, her really? Visual, that was the only visual spot. That was the only visual spot. The first time she used her blade, it just looked like a bad lightsaber effect.
Really?
That was the one thing that bothered me. As soon as it happened, I was like, damn it.
Because
when she pulled the sword out, right. And then she did the blade.
No, I just didn't notice that. And then she did
the
visual.
Blade, there was like four other things happening, but then as soon as she did it, I was like, why is it so long? And then I like looked at the blade, because they're playing her at the telekinetic level.
Right.
So they're playing her at a different power set already.
Yeah.
But she whips out this giant psi blade and it just looked like a cone.
Yeah.
Like a pokey cone. I was like, like, that kills. But that was the only moment, because after that, when she in the middle of the fight, when she turned into a whip, I thought that was really well done. People were complaining, like, oh, so she makes a sword that turns into a whip? Like, no, idiot, she's a telekinetic. She can make whatever the hell she wants.
Yeah.
So she makes a whip or a sword, depending on what the hell she wants.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, he's like, oh, wouldn't it have cut his leg off? And I was like, you're so dumb.
Listen.
What I would like for them to explore, I would like her to be explored in a series, honestly, because there's so much to her character, but here's where it gets gray, right? She's connected to Captain Marvel, or Captain Britain. Is Captain Britain in the MCU, or is he part of X-Men?
Yeah.
That's that gray line again, because I don't know who owns that, because she's his sister.
Can we both agree? I know, I thought incorrectly, and you corrected me on this, but can we still both agree that I feel like they do have some kind of agreement between each other, where one person gets Quicksilver because they're going to do it good, and the other person gets Scarlet Witch because
I don't think so. They both have the right to use them.
I know they have both the right to use.
I think X-Men could bring in Wanda really well.
I mean,
they played her as a younger sister for a reason.
Yeah,
and that could also in turn be a Polaris.
Yeah.
Polaris is another sister.
Sure.
So now we've had, visually, we've seen two sisters and a brother.
Right.
So that, to me, counts up Polaris, Wanda, and Quicksilver.
Right.
Quicksilver, obviously, is being used. Wanda was really young. She had red hair, so I'm presuming Wanda.
Right.
Magneto had four total children. The one that died. Oh, the dog. I was like, what's that noise? She is just chilling. It's hot.
Sure.
The one that died, which I can't remember her name, but whatever. Not the one in the movie. That was a completely different family. In the comics, what it was is he had a baby with the mother, Magda, the mother of Quicksilver and Wanda.
Uh-huh.
He had a baby with her, and she was sick, but they, like, the village had found out that he was a mutant. So they burned his house down.
Right.
And his baby was in there.
Yeah.
So this is the first time. Or not even that. No. They were gypsies.
Okay.
He hadn't even gotten his powers out
yet.
Or he hadn't used his powers a lot.
Yeah, I got
The first time he used his powers offensively to kill someone was right after that. Like, the house burned down. They wouldn't let him through. Like, they held him back from saving his daughter and wife.
Yeah.
Well, he thought it was his daughter and wife.
Sure.
His wife got away, and she had the twins later, because she was pregnant at the time, and gave them to the High Evolutionary, which is a whole other story.
Right, right.
Which has now apparently been retconned, and that never happened or some shit. Whatever, I'm not even discussing the current timeline to the stories. But what happened was the whole thing in the forest with the soldiers is a take from this beautiful Magneto moment. Is actually the book I gave Jackie, where he's in the forest and I think it was just two soldiers hunting him down, because this is right after that happened. So he just ran into the woods and they chased him down, and he's just like mourning. And they find him, and this is the first time he just, with anger, he makes them shoot each other. And that's kind of like where his like evil started.
I saw that scene,
and he was just like, he got the necklace, and I was like, oh, they're fucked. Dude, and it was just like all in one. I'll tell you right now,
I mean, I knew he was going to do something regardless. I'm like,
oh yeah, well, at this point, he was already established that he was willing to kill. They played him completely differently than the comics, but in the movies. But I think he was perfect. I think they could use Wanda if they wanted to. Polaris is another mutant that's another daughter.
Right, I got you.
With magnetic power, so that's one of those things, like, if he didn't want to do it anymore,
right.
Oh, Polaris is another...
No, I got you.
And...
I mean, I just felt like... I don't know.
The only caveat for Marvel is they can't say mutant, which is why they made them Inhumans, which is then why in the comics they made them Inhumans.
Yeah, I got you. I mean, I know why Marvel's doing what they're doing. This is clearly obvious at this point. I mean, if people aren't understanding why they're doing it, then I don't know what they're paying attention to, but I don't know. I felt like there's some kind of understanding between them two. I don't know. That's just me. Maybe I'm wrong. Who knows? But whatever. But I loved it. I loved it. I can't say anymore. I think it was perfect. That's about as much talking.
I can't wait for the next X-Men movie.
Oh, absolutely. Sinister is going to be great. And I agree with you. I hope Bryan Cranston does it. He has the voice for it. He's got the acting chops for it. I need him
to do the first line when Xavier meets him in the cartoon. And he says, "Who are you?" He's like, "The name is Sinister."
Yeah.
Mr.
Oh, I'm sure
Sinister.
He would. I was like...
As soon as I saw that interview, because before you even showed me that, I saw that interview like a year ago.
Yeah, no, me too. That's why I lost my mind. I was like, oh my God.
As soon as I saw that and I thought about his voice, and I'm like, if he executes that line, I will shit an actual physical brick in the theater.
Yeah, no, it's a phenomenal movie. I mean, I think we can end that there. That's that. All right, guys, so that is our review of X-Men Apocalypse. Once again, I know we won't all agree on what we've said here today, but that's the whole point of movies.
Drop your thoughts below.
We're just happy that they're making these movies. Absolutely. And really, that's all that matters. Absolutely. We're enjoying all of them except Fantastic Four.
Here's the thing. Superhero movies and Fast and the Furious are the only guaranteed things that get my money.
Yeah.
Superhero or sci-fi fantasy movies are the only guaranteed way to get my money at the box office.
I agree.
Because I'm sorry, before we had this huge wave of movies, dude, I cannot even tell you. Like, I saw X-Men.
Yeah.
And I saw the Fast and Furious movies. Before, like, Iron Man came out, I don't think I saw anything else in theaters.
Right, I got you.
Yeah, those were the two things. I saw X-Men, and I saw...
I want to say me and you saw Fast and Furious together. It was at Marcus.
Not the first one.
I want to say it was. And I want to say it was at Marcus.
It was at Marcus. I know I saw it at Marcus. I missed X-Men...
Not X-Men.
No, but I missed X-Men at the theater.
Uh-huh.
Like, we were supposed to go. For some reason, I couldn't. You went. That was Marcus. But, like I said, those were the only things I ever spent money on.
Yeah.
And then I spent more money once they did more of those movies. So that's one of those things, like, you vote with your wallet, which is something we always say. You know, if you don't think a movie's going to be good,
don't go see it
and then talk about, oh, it was so shitty.
Yeah.
If you don't think it's going to be good, if you don't think you're going to like it, you don't think you're going to get any enjoyment out of it,
then don't go see it.
Please don't go see it.
Because why support something if you know you're not going to like it?
I think Fantastic Four was the perfect example of voting with your wallet.
Here's the thing.
You had a few people go see it. that opening day,
yeah,
and everybody unanimously was like, this is ass. Yeah. This is complete ass.
Yeah.
I mean, and then everyone else was like, okay,
cool. Me and you went because we were hoping they could do good, right? We had hopes. They didn't, and we made sure we let everybody, I mean, everybody who watched it, know.
Yeah.
You know, it was an awful movie. Don't waste your time or money on it. Don't even see it on Netflix or whatever you got. Just don't do it. It's not worth it. So... I'm gonna watch it again
just because I like, you know, to punish myself.
Absolutely.
but I like watching all these kinds of movies. Like the two movies that I've never finished, which are based on video games, which were Blood Rain. I never finished either of them.
Those are awful.
They're awful movies. They're just really, really awful movies. Awful.
That's why when somebody says something is awful, I'm like, so you're saying it's as bad as this? Because I need you to acknowledge what
the bottom
awful
of the barrel,
is.
Guys. The bottom of the barrel is.
It's probably Blood Rain.
Blood Rain, because
and
I could
Fantastic
not
Four.
Fantastic Four, I think.
Is right above Blood
Rain. I stayed in the theater because I can't.
Yeah,
I can't
you don't
walk
want,
out.
I mean, you
I paid for it.
Yeah, I was gonna say you could. But
I paid,
you paid
for
it.
And I'm a person who wants to know the story.
Yeah.
So when I watched Blood Rain, it was like right when it came out. It was like 2003, 2004. Awesome, awful graphics.
Yeah.
Awful graphics, awful everything. So listen, it was one of those things that like I watched it rented. I think I worked at Blockbuster at the time, so like I rented it. Didn't like it.
Well,
it didn't cost me a dime,
I
didn't care.
For me, because I was watching a movie, and it was a preview before the movie. It was a B-rated movie, but I liked that B-rated movie.
Yeah.
But I was like, oh, okay, Blood Rain. I know Blood Rain.
Sure.
I'm like, this might be cool. This might be dope. And I was like, because I was watching, it was just around the moment where I watched that one zombie/vampire movie that we just recently were talking about, where it had Hellboy in it and stuff like that. I forgot the name of it, but it was just around that
Mute
period.
Chronicles.
Yes, thank you. Ah, he remembered.
You said Hellboy, and I was like, you must mean Ron Perlman.
Yeah. And that's dope. That's good. It was just around that time when I was watching all that. I'm like, oh, man, I'm really excited. I want to watch more of this stuff. And I'm like, Blood Rain? They made a Blood Rain? So I picked it up. I mean, I didn't buy it. I rented it. This is once again when those things were still around. And I stopped watching 2 minutes in. I was like, oh my God, this is awful.
I watched the first one like 3/4 of the way through. It was one of those things where I watched it late.
Right.
So I was tired.
Yeah, so you were
happened. Listen, guys, you got to understand. I passed out. I still to this day have not seen Scarface. I own it. I haven't seen it.
Yeah.
Because the one time I sat down to watch it, it was after I worked 6 hours.
Yeah.
I went to Imani's house, and we started watching Scarface, and
you got tired.
He had the most comfortable fucking lounge chairs.
Yeah.
So I'm in this like recliner. We're starting to watch Scarface. I pass out right around that conversation of all I got in this world is my money and my balls.
Yeah,
and I don't break either of them for nothing or my word and my balls.
Yeah.
And I woke up at. Say hello to my little friend. And I was like, I should probably go. Like, I'm tired of shit. I missed a lot, apparently. Like, I don't know what's happened. Right, I'm going to go.
But let's finish this up. We've already tried to end this video.
Seriously.
Slash.
Great movie.
Great movie.
Make more movies.
Go watch it. It's phenomenal. Don't listen to the people that are bitching about it because... those people don't know what they want because we don't and the creators don't. So there's no way they know.
To me, this is like my rule. If it's universally liked, it's most likely going to be good, at the very least good.
Yeah.
If it's universally despised
by everybody.
By everybody.
I'm talking
and
about
I mean not,
fans
and critics. And not like despise like Batman v Superman was. Because every single person that reviewed that was like, I like the movie, but here are the problems I had with
it. Yeah, yeah.
And they listed a lot of problems, but that's because that's their job is to nitpick movies.
Yeah, yeah.
But like they say,
but here's
I
the
like
thing.
The movies, but like
but most
Fantastic,
of the audience liked it.
Yeah, but Fantastic Four.
Nobody liked it.
Nobody liked it.
Nope.
Nobody said, I liked the movie. Except, well, like, two people said, like, I could have liked the movie up until, or like, 10 minutes in, I was ready, and then it just spiraled.
Yeah,
and that's kind of the setup. Is that the beginning of that movie was good because they took it basically scene for scene from a comic, and then once they diverted from that, is when it really went to shit. So go see this movie.
Go see the
make
movie.
Up your own mind. Listen, if you don't want to Put in the whole $10, $12, whatever tickets cost
now.
Go see
Matinee or the Dolly Theater if you wait long enough.
Wait another couple weeks. You gotta understand, it is the summer season. Last week, X-Men came out. This week, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Oh my god, I'm super excited.
Next week, Warcraft comes out.
Oh my god, man.
These movies are gonna cycle out of theaters very, very fast.
Yeah, they're gonna go fast.
X-Men might get 4 weeks, five if we're lucky.
If we're lucky. I mean, we're talking about Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and let's say that doesn't do well enough, which I don't see why not, because the first one
gonna be a huge family movie.
Then you got Warcraft, and that's gonna take all the money.
Warcraft has been getting some nasty reviews.
Nasty isn't bad?
Bad.
Bad. Here's the thing. That's fine because that movie was literally made for fans, so...
I feel like we're going to get a lot more out of it than most people will.
Yeah.
But still, if you like fantasy, go see it. You know, it's...
I'm excited.
Listen, we're going to finally finish this up.
We're done!
Thank you for watching.
Thank you.
That was our review. Make sure to subscribe to both, because this is going to also be a podcast. So whatever you do on the podcast section, follow, subscribe, whatever you need
podcast
to do.
Podcast links down below.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Make sure to hit that like if you're watching on YouTube. If you're listening to the subscribe heart or to the podcast.
Favorite it, like
favorite
it,
whatever
it is that
needs
you do,
to be done.
Share it with your friends.
Thank you guys so much, and we will see you in the next one.
Signing off.